your centenary year. It's a wonderful time to celebrate a great tradition of a football club, the history, the great successes, wonderful players I've had. And I just hope that everyone goes and enjoys it and recognises a truly wonderful time for the football club.
As Aberdeen Football Club celebrates its first 100 years, now's the time for fans to remember the past, to reminisce about great games and legendary names, to recall the highs and the lows, and to reflect on why they and the club embarked on a lifelong love affair. During the past century, there have been many successful spells, the most glorious of which was the never-to-be-forgotten Alex Ferguson era, when the Dons weren't just the best team in Scotland. For a couple of years, Aberdeen could rightly claim to be the best team in Europe. It all began on the 14th of April 1903, when Aberdeen, Orion and Victoria finally amalgamated to form the new Aberdeen FC. Pittodrie Park, home of the original Aberdeen, was chosen as the new club's base, and £1,500 worth of shares were issued. A bid to join the Scottish Football League was rejected, so Aberdeen began life in the Northern League, with Jimmy Phillip as manager and Peter Simpson as trainer. The first strip comprised the white shirts worn by the old Aberdeen, their opposition the likes of Forfar, Stenhousemuir and Lochgelly United. The following year saw Aberdeen elected to the second division, and their Scottish League debut ended in a 2-1 home defeat at the hands of Falkirk. The Wasps, so-called because of their new black and gold shirts, ended that season in seventh place, but were finally admitted to the first division. Aberdeen had reached the top flight of Scottish football, a position they've never relinquished since. It's a proud boast that the club, despite a few scares, has never endured the bitter taste of relegation. Pittodrie underwent the first of its many changes in 1905, when a new stand and pavilion were erected to replace the old one originally re-sited from Orion's Catterfield ground. The early days were a struggle, but by season 1910-11, Aberdeen were mounting their first serious title challenge. Two men who would have a huge part to play in the future, Donald Coleman and Pat Travers, were on board by them, and the team eventually finished championship runners-up, having faltered only in the last few weeks of the campaign. The years after the First World War saw the arrival of a number of players who would make a significant impact. Jock Hutton from Bells Hill became a huge favourite and played almost 300 games. Harry Blackwell and Matt Forsyth completed over 400 games between them, and John Miller set a new club record of 23 goals in 36 league games in season 21-22.
Thank you.
February 1923 saw the Dons record their record win. Walter Grant scored four and Vic Milne a hat-trick as Peterhead were thrashed 13-0 in a Scottish Cup third-round tie. Pat Travers returned as trainer that year and was promoted to manager 2 years later when Jimmy Phillip retired after more than two decades in charge. Travers' first season was illuminated by the emergence of young Alex Jackson, a future Wembley wizard. 8 goals in 40 matches doesn't begin to tell the story. The Pittodrie faithful were watching a Scottish football legend in the making. The discovery of the 1927 tour of South Africa, Benny Yorston, also emerged. Benny scored 126 goals in 5 years, becoming along the way the first Aberdeen player to hit a century in the Scottish League. Willie Cooper began his 21-year stint with Aberdeen. And Travers put together one of the club's most famous halfback lines, Black, McLaren and Hill. Jimmy Black, Hugh McLaren and Frank Hill played 400 games between them and were a major part in the club's revival at that time. Another who graced Pittodrie in that era was Alex Cheen, the man created with sparking the famous Hampden Roar when scoring direct from a corner for Scotland against England in 1929. Cheen spent 5 years with Aberdeen before moving to Chelsea for a record fee of £6,000. Travers' exciting team almost landed Aberdeen's first title in 1930, but eventually had to settle for third, despite Yorston's club record 38 league goals in as many games. The following season was marred by what became known as the Great Mystery, a controversy which ended the Aberdeen careers of some star names. Hugh McLaren, Frank Hill and Benny Yorston were dropped, along with David Galloway and Jimmy Black. The club would only admit to some domestic trouble.
There was a bit of a scam where five players at least were involved in a fixed odds bet with Will Jimison, the bookie in Aberdeen. The plan was that they would be drawing at half-time, winning at full-time. Okay, you could say they were still planning to win, but they were corrupting the game by planning to draw at half-time. And I had to dig out to the main culprit, supposed to be, who was the great Benny Yorston, the top goal scorer of all time until, you know, Joe Harper's time. And decided I had to track him down. Everybody thought he was dead, but I found him in a hovel in London and finally confronted him with it. He'd had a heart attack and I didn't want to be too hard on him. He wouldn't confess it at all, pretended he didn't even know what I was talking about. But I knew, and sadly he had another heart attack not long after I left.
The mystery occurred shortly after Donald Coleman's return as trainer, and between them, Travers and Coleman set about rebuilding the team. It would, however, be another 6 years before Aberdeen were again challenging for the championship. Coleman was a revolutionary, and it was around that time he introduced dugouts at Pittodrie, an idea which would be copied the world over. By the mid-1930s, Matt Armstrong and Willie Mills were leading the line. The pair scored nearly 300 goals between them during their Aberdeen careers. Third place in 1936, the addition of left-winger Billy Strauss helped the club to second place a year later, and more notably, to Aberdeen's first Scottish Cup final. Strauss sadly missed the final through injury, as a record crowd of 146,433 assembled at Hampden Park, with an estimated 20,000 more fans locked out. There was to be no fairy tale, as despite Armstrong's goal, Celtic emerged 2-1 winners, but the Dons had at least made the breakthrough. There was heartbreak in that summer's tour of South Africa when the club lost one of its best-loved players. Jackie Benyon went down with appendicitis and died soon after of peritonitis in a Johannesburg hospital. The shock departure of Pat Travers to Clyde saw Davy Halliday installed as Aberdeen's third manager, and the sale of Willie Mills caused further instability. Red shirts and white shorts replaced the famous black and gold, and the Dons finished the 38-39 season in a credible third place.
The football programme during the Second World War was naturally haphazard, and when the conflict ended, season 1945-46 was already underway, and the Dons were about to claim their first national trophy after 43 years in existence.
On the 11th of May 1946, a date forever etched in Dons' hearts thanks to later exploits, the club won the Southern League Cup, Archie Baird and Stan Williams carved out a 2-0 lead over Rangers at Hampden. The Ibrox men hit back, but George Taylor fired home a late winner. At last, the long wait was over. There was major silverware in the Pittodrie trophy cabinet.
We were all gathered around the radio. The Dons were 2-0, then Rangers equalised, and then very last minute of the game, Peter Thompson, the commentator, who was known to be a bit of a blue nose, said, "And now here's Cowie going for the ball, here's Williams going for the ball, and Taylor goes for the ball." And then there was just a shout, and then I had a wail, "Aberdeen have scored." The unbiased commentator, Richard, you'll know all about that.
Well, that was the day we played Rangers. Remember, it was a beautiful day, and the people come down from Aberdeen hoping to win Aberdeen win their first cup ever. There was a story in Aberdeen that the young swains were asked to name the day to the marriage, and they would always say when Aberdeen won the cup, because they knew they were in a good thing. But that day we surprised everybody. I don't know if we didn't surprise ourselves. And I remember, of course, the first minute when Andy Cowie took a long throw in, George Hamilton backheaded, and I somehow climbed above big George Young and nodded it into the net. And from then on, it wasn't straight sailing as that, because Rangers fought back, and it was only in about the last minute, I think, that George Taylor got the winning goal.
Defeat in the first official League Cup final 12 months later was a bitter pill to swallow. But Aberdeen bounced back and returned to Hampden to take on Hibernian in the Scottish Cup final. Tragically, the veteran Willie Cooper was absent, an injury victim, and the Dons lost an early goal. George Hamilton equalised, and Stan Williams scored what turned out to be the winner from an acute angle. Not even a missed second-half penalty could deny the Dons. Aberdeen were at last Scottish Cup winners.
Going out into that pitch of Hampden with over 100,000 people is a thing that not many people really have done. The great thing about these days was that there was a camaraderie even amongst rival supporters. The mix, there was no segregation. They mixed with each other, and they cheered on their team, but there was none of the aggravation that there is today. And the whole thing was just a wonderful spectacle. But it was a great day all over. And then we came back a couple of days later, and we were the first team, I think, to use the open-top bus through the streets. And there were thousands and thousands of the streets to cheer us that day. That is a thing that I'll always remember.
That day in 47, when they won the Scottish Cup for the first time, it was really a great day. It was the second time I'd been to Hampden, but what a memory that was. They presented the cup out in the field, which I think is where cups ought to be. Nowadays, I'm not sure you could do that.
As some of the greats moved on or retired, the next few years saw decline set in. Youngsters were recruited, the likes of Harry Yorston and Chris Anderson, and what an impact he would make in future years. But the Dons were struggling, and at times the spectre of relegation hovered threateningly over the club.
The beginning of the new decade saw Halliday continue to reshape his side. Gentleman George Hamilton was back at the club, and the fans saw the introduction of the likes of goalkeeper Fred Martin, centre-half Alec Young, future club captain Archie Glenn, the prolific Graham Leggett snapped up from Banks Adee, lightning-fast winger Jackie Hather, and another regular marksman, Paddy Buckley. And these new players steered the club to the Scottish Cup final, where they confounded the experts with a 1-1 draw against Rangers.
The ball goes over to John Prentice, who sends it on to Peyton. Alec Young challenges, but Peyton gets it over to Hubbard. Further upfield, John Prentice takes over and has a slam, and there it is. Rangers are one up within the first 7 minutes. Harris again. He sends one towards the Ibrox goal where there's plenty of action until a shot at the net gives goalie Niven the chance of clearing. But Aberdeen don't give him much chance to recover before they're back again. Hather to Harry Yorston, who gives a quick header to send it in to make it 1-1 within the last 10 minutes of the match. Aberdeen and Rangers will meet again.
Although defeated in the replay, It was a team to be reckoned with. Evidence came in an astonishing 6-0 Scottish Cup semi-final win over Rangers in 1954.
Spectators are there to see if Rangers can recapture their past glories and win their way to the final tussle with Celtic. Aberdeen get the ball away, and away they go. Joe O'Neill has a slam, and he scored. O'Neill, who came out of hospital only a few weeks ago, wins his teammates' congratulations. And again, it's Aberdeen on the attack. Now Joe O'Neill smacks it home, 2-0. Leggett shoots, and there's the Dons' third goal. Joe O'Neill soon makes it 4-0. In the last few minutes, the Dons take a corner, but O'Neill is fouled, and that means a penalty. Alistair makes no mistake. Buckley scores another, so by 6-0, Aberdeen go on to the final.
But the Dons lost out in two successive finals to the Old Firm. Greater glory, however, lay just around the corner. Having suffered just three league defeats, Aberdeen entered 1955 6 points clear at the top of the table. The good form was maintained, and despite being denied a third successive Scottish Cup final by Clyde, a 4-0 thrashing of Rangers paved the way to the title. On the 9th of April, Clyde were again the opposition at Shawfield, and an Archie Glenn penalty was enough to clinch the points. For the first time in their history, Aberdeen were Scottish champions. Halliday went out at the top, moving to Leicester, and trainer Dave Shaw stepped up into the manager's office. There was early success, Graham Leggett scoring the winner in a 2-1 triumph over St Mirren as the Dons lifted the League Cup for the second time. But the champions relaxed their grip on the title, having to settle for runners-up spot. Once again, decline followed success. Harry Yorston retired at 28 to become a fish market porter. Buckley and Young saw their careers ended by injury, and Leggett was sold to Fulham. In April 1959, Norman Davidson scored twice at Ibrox to prevent relegation. Despite their poor league form, the Dons had reached another Scottish Cup final. Hugh Baird got a hand in goal, but St Mirren ran out 3-1 winners.
Into Wishart, Wishart through again to Baird. Baird going through for Aberdeen, trying a shot, and it's a goal. A goal by Hugh Baird, but it doesn't really matter, because I make it time up.
The first televised league match at Pittodrie was broadcast on December the 26th, 1959. A Boxing Day bonanza, with the Dons defeating Hibs 6-4.
The Hibernian side is the same as that which took 10 goals from Partick Thistle last week. And Aberdeen have one change. Outside left, Heather comes in at inside left for Bobby Wishart. Canell for Aberdeen. To Heather. Heather, a nice ball inside. Mahal's going in. Mahal across the face of the goal, and a beautiful goal by Davison. A first-time shot by Davison sent the ball hurtling into the net. 32 minutes played. Aberdeen 1, Hibernian 2. A very nice move. Heather, Mahal, and the finishing touch put by Davison. A ball through in the middle to Davison, who looks very much offside. Davison puts the ball across the goal. Here's Mahal, he must score. Mahal scores! Yes, 2 each. Great roar from the Aberdeen supporters as Sim puts this ball into goal. Punched away by Ryan very nicely. A lob first time across the goal. A shot, a fluff shot. Davison gets it in front of the goal. Davison pushed down and a penalty kick. I think it's centre-half Clooney. Yes, Clooney is going to take this penalty. Rather difficult to see. Almost in the stroke of half-time. Here he goes. Here it is. And a remarkable comeback by Aberdeen, who have gone from 2 down to 3-2 in the lead. Davison picks up that bad pass, Heather going through. Heather shoots, the ball running loose, and Heather gets the rebound as the ball dropped from Rand to score Aberdeen's fourth goal. A sad mistake by the Hibernian keeper. Heather got through, he shot. Rand was down, he had the ball, but it broke loose. And Heather, following up, swept the ball into the net for his side's fourth goal on the hour. And with half an hour to go, it's Aberdeen 4, Hibernian 2. And I notice that Mulhall has come across to outside right in this Aberdeen side. Well, Brownlee has certainly been the weak link so far. The ball pushed through to Davison in the clear. And Davison flicks the ball into the net. 5-2. Once again, a suggestion of offside about that. No signal from the near linesman. And the Hibernian defence looking absolutely aghast. Free kick to Aberdeen. Some 10 minutes to go. There it goes, curving into goal. Brent misses it, headed towards the goal, into the net. Davidson, 6-3. Another goalkeeping blunder by Wren. And that should finally put the seal in the game.
The evolution of Pittodrie continued with the introduction of floodlights that year, but months later, the lights went out on Shaw's reign. Tommy Pearson stepping up from youth coach to take over in the manager's office. It was to be an inglorious period, however. No Hampden appearances and mid-table league football. In early 1965, following an 8-0 defeat at Celtic Park and a Scottish Cup dismissal at the hands of 2nd Division East Fife, Pearson walked out of the manager's office for the last time. His replacement was to be the Queen's Park coach, Eddie Turnbull, whose methods would revolutionise the club.
When I first went up, the first impression that I got was not really very good. The players had no discipline about them for a start. You know, they were coming and going as they wanted. And I thought, when I looked, I thought, I've got a job to do here, I have a big job to do.
As soon as Eddie Turnbull took over, the plays just changed dramatically. Every day the training was different and it varied it. And, you know, the likes of the young guys at the time used to take us back in the afternoons and had us working and were deficiencies, which was plenty. But the plays just turned upside down completely.
Initially, Turnbull took stock. The result was 17 players being handed free transfers. He brought Bobby Clark with him from Queen's Park and relied initially on experienced signings like Harry Melrose and Jim Storey.
We managed to stay up in the league. We were struggling to avoid relegation, but we managed to do it. Then I thought, I have a huge task on here, and I had to change virtually everything. I had to get rid of the dead wood, for starters, and I had to have a plan and let the players know and try and get these players to really see what all this was about, because none of them had any real knowledge of football.
Turnbull's training regime was totally different. The emphasis switched and the players saw more of the ball on non-match days. He was a strong character, imposed strict discipline and got the best out of his charges.
Every player had a ball. They couldn't believe this. They had a ball, and this obviously was balls to improve their skills. I used to say to them, now treat that ball as though it's your girlfriend, you know. Caress her and what have you, and just do the same to the ball, you know. And they had never seen this before. I don't know if any other Scottish team did this or not, but I wasn't interested in that. All I was interested in was these boys at Aberdeen.
To me, he was like a father. You know, he took me from Morton, and he treated me like a son that he never had. And I mean, very often when you say that, you know, sometimes you treat your son harder than you would anybody else, and that was Eddie. The amount of times he used to take me back in the afternoons for a wee bit of extra training, and he would come and he'd be there. The amount of times we trained after we'd finished training, we stayed for 20 minutes, half an hour, taking penalty kicks, free kicks, etc. And it was always competitive. And that was the other thing about him. He taught every player there, whether it be table tennis, snooker, tiddlywinks, be competitive. If you do it during the week, you'll do it on a Saturday. And to me, he was the one who revolutionised the whole of Aberdeen Football Club.
Turnbull got the Dons back to Hampden, but missed the Scottish Cup final through illness as his reshaped team went down 2-0 to Celtic. Fourth place in the league that season led to the club's first adventure in Europe, and it started with a record 10-0 victory over the Icelandic side Reykjavik.
I thought, now this is what I've been striving for. Because I had tasted you, I played in Europe the first time there ever was a European Cup competition. And we reached the semi, so I knew how players would feel playing in Europe, you know. And I thought, this is something these boys have got to experience. Not many people at that particular time experienced playing in Europe, you know. And it was great for the lads. And they responded. They did very well, actually.
This is where it all began for me, hanging over the wall of the South Stand, brought along by my old dad to watch the likes of Bobby Clark and Martin Buchan, Joe Harper and Arthur Graham. Season 69-70, my first as a Dons fan, one which was to end in Hampden glory.
Young, fresh talent was introduced by Turnbull in the shape of Tommy Craig, Jimmy Smith and Martin Buchan. Craig and Smith were sold for six-figure sums and replaced by the legendary Joe Harper, by Jim Forrest and, for a short but altogether memorable spell, by Derek Mackay. In January 1970, the Dons set off on their Scottish Cup campaign with a 4-0 beating of Clyde. Second Division Clydebank were disposed of 2-1, but the team was booed from the park. Enter Cup tie Mackay. The McDuff youngster got the only goal of the quarter-final at Falkirk and repeated the feat in the semis against Kilmarnock at Muirton Park. On the 11th of April, Mackay struck twice more at Hampden and Joe Harper netted a penalty as the Dons trounced odds-on favourite Celtic by 3-1.
Celtic skipper Billy McNeil wins the touch. With three wins in the four cup finals since 1965, Celtic are firm favourites. But Aberdeen, refusing to be overawed by their opponent's glittering record, moves smoothly into attack. A dangerous moment for Celtic, but the ball was clear. Aberdeen have a really great chance after being awarded a controversial penalty, but there's no dispute about the kick by Aberdeen's Joe Harper, which put them one up. Celtic pull out all the stops in the second half to try and get the equaliser, but they're still being hard-pressed by the confident Aberdeen forward. In the 82nd minute, Aberdeen break away. A move involving Forrest and Harper gives young Derek Mackay the chance to make it 2-0. Now, when Aberdeen seems to have the game in their pocket, Celtic go very close with this corner kick. And with just 2 minutes to go, Celtic's Bobby Lennox beats Jolly Clough. But in the very last minute, Mackay whipped in Aberdeen's third goal. A 3-1 victory. Celtic had hoped to add the cup to their Scottish League and Scottish League Cup triumphs. It was a remarkable but well-deserved victory for Aberdeen.
And as Joe Harper reveals 30-odd years later, Eddie Turnbull's man management skills played a huge part in that famous victory.
It was a great build-up to it. We actually went to Glen Eagles Hotel and Eddie was a great motivator and a great person for getting. He knew his players. He knew how to react to players, how to treat them. And Bobby Clark was a great guy, you know, for talking about football all the time. And he was always seemed to be calm. But, you know, Eddie wanted him really up for this game because he knew that he was one of the main cogs in the team. In the morning, in Glen Eagles, we went for breakfast. And Bobby always liked his glass of milk in the morning. And Eddie refused him. He says, "No, you're not having milk. You're not allowed milk. What about orange juice? No, you're not allowed orange juice. You can have water or tea, that's it." And Bobby got so irate at this and so angry at it that he went out and he was absolutely brilliant during the game because he kept thinking, you know, the anger was showing through even in the games. He's coming through and he's punching balls 30, 40 yards. Just that sort of thing, you know, the build-up to it. There was never any pressure put on us. It was the great Celtic team that had won European Cups. He just said to us, "Go out, enjoy yourselves." He says, "And if you play the football that I know you can play," he says, "you'll win this game easily."
And what did you think of this reception tonight in Aberdeen?
Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful.
To make all the tension worthwhile?
Yes, indeed.
Would you do it again?
Many times.
After 15 long years, Aberdeen were winners again, and a legend was born. Derek Mackay played in just 19 first-team games and scored 4 goals. yet he truly deserves his place in the club's roll of honour.
It was just magnificent, Derek Mackay scoring. You know, what a fairy tale that was. A boy coming into the team because of an injury, scored in the quarter-final, the only goal, scored in the semi-final, the only goal, and comes into the final and scores two and, you know, becomes Cup tie Mackay overnight. And I remember a journalist after the game saying to me during the week, he interviewed me, and he says, you must have been really nervous taking the penalty kick. You know, I was 21, nerves weren't in my vocabulary. I says, no. He says, but you must have been. He says, it was held up for 7 or 8 minutes. He says, you were keeping the ball up. He says, what was going through your mind? And I thought, well, if I score the only goal here, I says, I'll get any girl I want in Aberdeen. He says, did you? I says, no, Cup tie scored two. He got them all.
Still, Aberdeen can't get that ball in the net. Graham. No one can say they didn't try this half with long shooting. And it's a goal! A goal by Harper. Carmen Yanni again got a hand to that, but couldn't stop it going in the net.
With Martin Buchan superbly marshalling the defence and Joe Harper scoring goals for fun, Aberdeen won 15 games in a row the following season to lead the table. Bobby Clark set a new world record for shutouts, 12 successive clean sheets contributing to the Dons' magnificent run. In February, the main stand at Pittodrie was badly damaged in a fire, and that afternoon the Dons lost 1-0 at Dunfermline. Celtic clawed the Dons back to set up a virtual title decider in mid-April, and the point they snatched that afternoon tipped the balance. Eddie Turnbull's Aberdeen had to settle for runners-up.
Just when it seemed another successful era was on the cards, it all fell apart. Turnbull was tempted back to his first love, Hibernian. Martin Buchan sold to Manchester United, and goal-scoring legend Joe Harper transferred to Everton. Jimmy Bonthrone took over as boss and began with a Driver Cup success against Celtic, the 2-1 win marking the opening of the new-look paddock with its bench seating.
And to the old and beautiful city of Aberdeen, Cup final day comes early. On the Saturday before the 1971-72 season begins, it's the final of the Driver Cup. And from all round the Granite City and from Glasgow in the south, the fans have come to see the battle between the teams who finished in first and second place in the league championship the previous season. Aberdeen reached the final of the Driver Cup by beating East Fife and Airdrie. Celtic got there by beating Dumbarton and St Johnston. And inside the ground, a crowd of almost 30,000 waiting for the big moment. 5-3, out come the teams led by the respective captains Martin Buchan of Aberdeen and Billy McNeil of Celtic. Both teams wearing armbands as a tribute to the former Aberdeen and Celtic wing half, Joe McLaughlin. Referee for the big game, Mr. Ian Foote from Glasgow. So it's Aberdeen kicking off, attacking the goal on your right. And right away it's Vic Davidson pushing a ball through towards McCarry. Harry Hood racing in. Bobby Clark gets his first touch of the ball. Again it's Aberdeen on the attack. Steve Murray through, Rob onto the left wing. Arthur Graham making down very, very quickly indeed. A fine header there, but Williams is watching it turned away for a corner kick. Almost the first goal for Aberdeen. The flying header just over the top this time from George Buchan. Jim Craig intercepting. Up to the halfway line. Again, it's Callaghan. Davidson on his right. Nice ball through to Dalglish, but outside left, Graham is there. And Aberdeen decide to come forward. Fine play here by Graham. Robin Harper moving into the centre, a lovely ball across. And Rob's there, it's there. Goal number one for Aberdeen. The time, 20 minutes. Beautiful flick there from Davy Robb. Jubilant Aberdeen supporters. Steve Murray, number four. David Hay in overhead clearance, but a snapshot there from Harper almost catches Williams unawares. Ball at the edge of the box, stumps one in, a real chance for goal number two, but it's over the top this time from Joe Harper. An exciting first half ends with Aberdeen leading by that Dave Robb goal, 1-0. Great chance here for goal number two. Robb's shot blocked by McNeil. Hood back in defence helping out. Aberdeen turning the screw in these the opening moments of the second half. Willoughby down the touchline with the throw. Left back Hermiston up with his forwards getting it across. Flick away by Connolly. Out to the powerful Hughes. Martin Buchan mopping up the danger. Harper and Connolly having a tussle. And back to Evan Williams. Dalglish has it. Hughes is in the centre. Dalglish gets it across and Hughes is there. It's the equaliser. 58 minutes have gone. Aberdeen 1, Celtic 1. Martin Buchan, a long ball downfield. McNeil scurrying back into position. The Celtic fans shouting the team on. Harper inside the box. Down he comes. Is it a penalty? Mr. Foote says yes. So Joe Harper to take the penalty kick himself. And it's there. Aberdeen lead 2-1. 63 minutes have gone. Great jubilation among the Aberdeen players, leading for the second time in this match. And there's what the supporters think of it. Hughes at the edge of the box. To Callaghan, a quick change of feet and a good shot, but a good save from Clark. Aberdeen still leading 2-1. Johnston again. Beautiful return pass and a fine close-in shot, but again, Clark's equal to the occasion. Aberdeen's defence coming out. And there goes the final whistle. It's all over. Aberdeen have beaten Celtic in the final of the Drivers' Cup. A sea of red and white as the players go forward to collect the trophy and their winners' medals from Simon Fergill, the chairman of Drivers'. There's Martin Buchan, the happiest man inside Pittodrie, with the Drivers' Cup. Right behind him, Bobby Clark, who did so well in that second half when Celtic were pressing hard. Joe Harper, the man who scored the penalty kick winner. A marvellous moment for all the Aberdeen players and their spectators. Jim Hermiston there with the cup. Alec Willoughby with his medal. And Dave Robb, who scored the first goal. The two substitutes, Andy Gierken and Tom McMillan.
Anderson. Graham quickly on his feet, headed by Jarvie. Arthur Graham really bounced to his feet there as he had slipped down, made a perfect cross, and Drew Jarvie rose to head it beautifully past Phil Kearney. Headed out by Boyd. Graham. And Drew Jarvie scores, the ball coming across there. Drew Jarvie leaping up to head, 37 minutes played, coming across from Arthur Graham. Drew Jarvie scores his second goal of the game in a cluster of Aberdeen players. Aberdeen now lead by three goals to nil, and an excellent header by Jarvie. Well, nobody could really say Clyde have played badly, it's just that Aberdeen have played better. Away goes Hermiston, a cut back, and driven in by Miller. Hermiston, immaculate fullback that he is, running through there, could have shot, decided not to, cut the ball unselfishly to Willie Miller, and he has put Aberdeen into a 4-0 lead.
Drew Jarvie, Willie Miller and Willie Young came to prominence during the Bond Throne years, and there was a cameo appearance from Zoltán Varga, whose few short months left many fans convinced that the Hungarian is the best player ever to pull on a Don shirt. But overall it was less than impressive, and Jimmy Bonthrone quit in October 1975 following a 2-1 defeat by Celtic at Pittodrie.
Robbed through the centre to Scott. Great chance and a goal. 14 minutes played in the second half. Jockey Scott scores his own fifth goal of the season and breathes fresh life back into Aberdeen.
Pittodrie needed something special, and it arrived in the shape of Ali McLeod. The extrovert former Ayr United boss breezed into the North East, and his mixture of enthusiasm and self-confidence immediately won over the fans.
Ali came with his personality and his enthusiasm, and it certainly affected the team, the players, and the city. I think the club, the town, everybody got a huge lift from Ali's personality. I would say that he was a bit of a nightmare to train with, I've got to say that, because some of his training routines were unbelievable. You know, we'd have a training session and you'd be leading 2-0 and the next goal would be worth three goals. Or you'd be shooting one way away to put the ball in the back of the net, and Ali would say, OK, you're shooting the other way, so you had to turn around and start shooting the other goals. So it was a strange kind of an era that we had with Ali McLeod, but thoroughly enjoyable.
What a character, you know, a motivator through and through. Some of the training was bizarre, you know, we'd play head tennis in about 3 foot of snow and things like that, and he'd have players diving about. We used to go down to the beach and train on the beach when the tide was in. He'd run about in about 4 feet of water trying to, oh God. But, you know, the boys loved him, everybody loved him for it, and he was just a great motivator, a great one for getting players up. He used to wind Bobby Clark up some terrible at training on the pitch, you know. He always played against Bobby, and if the ball went 5 yards over an imaginary bar, he would say goal, and Bobby would argue with him, and Bobby would mark his score down in the ash, and, you know, Ali would say, right, that's us, we're 14-10 up, and Bobby says, no, we're 10-4 up, you know, and things like that. So just a great motivator, a great character, lovely man, lovely family, and everybody really adored him.
The team slipped back into relegation trouble and only survived thanks to a final day 3-0 beating of Hibernian. But the next season was to be memorable for entirely different reasons. McLeod brought back the King, Joe Harper from Hibs, and signed Stuart Kennedy from Falkirk and Dom Sullivan from Clyde. Jockey Scott and Drew Jarvie were emerging as key players. Only Dave Robb and Bobby Clark remained from Turnbull's team. The season began on a wave of optimism. A good run in the Premier Division, matched by the Dons' League Cup form. They topped their section, eventually saw off Stirling Albion in a quarter-final replay, and then dismantled Rangers at Hampden. Scott fired a hat-trick as Aberdeen thrashed the Ibrox side 5-1.
Knocked out there by Williamson. That's good running. Sullivan needs a final touch. That's a great ball. There's a goal. Jockey Scott. 2 minutes gone. Aberdeen 1, Rangers nothing. Graham, that's a beautiful ball. Scott with a chance. It's the second one. That's his second. 14 minutes of the first half gone. Aberdeen 2, Rangers nothing. And it looked so simple, didn't it? Watch it again from Sullivan. Brush down towards Scott and promptly in the back of the net. Graham's there, Sullivan's there for this free kick. Sullivan with it. That's it! Jockey Scott's hat-trick. 5-1, 27 minutes of the second half gone. And he must be a delighted man.
McLeod could hardly contain himself. Back at Hampden for the first time in 6 years, the Dons beat Celtic 2-1 in a dramatic final. Davy Robb scoring an extra-time winner, just as Bobby Clark had dreamt he would do the night before.
Miller going forward. That's him now. Two men on the right. This is Kennedy. Graham on the far side. This is him now. Sullivan coming across. Graham turns it straight across goal. Harper out in front. Jarvie scores. Drew Jarvie makes it 1-1. Beautiful header. 24 minutes gone. 1-1 it is, yes, 1-1, and Jarvie has scored. Williamson going forward. Graham putting a lot of work into it. Scott's onside. Graham. Robb.
It's in the net. Robb scores. David Robb scores for Aberdeen. 2 minutes played in the first period of extra time, and David Robb absolutely jubilant. There's Willie Miller receiving the lead cut and wait for the roar. And that's the biggest smile you'll see at Hampden Park today. The rain streaming down. Ali McLeod absolutely unaware of it.
I remember that game particularly well against Celtic in the League Cup final. What it meant for me, it gave me the opportunity as team captain to lift the trophy. That was a huge honour. Probably the memory is perhaps the story of Davy Robb when he was left out of the team, and Bobby Clark, who was an amazing person, seemingly had this dream that it was going to be Davy's Cup final, and he was going to come on and score the winner. And he did tell us that before the game, and it actually happened. I think that kind of sums up Ali's era and Bobby Clark and his dreams. And David Robb came on and put the winner away. And, you know, we went up and we lifted the trophy, and that was the start of some good times at Hampden, for myself in particular.
And the moment the Aberdeen fans have really been waiting for, the return of their heroes from Hampden Park, the men who won the League Cup final, back they come to Pittodrie. And see the welcome they're getting. Hundreds of fans milling about the open-top bus after having been given a marvellous welcome in the main streets of the city and been received by the Lord Provost, Mr. Robert Lennox. And out comes the man of the moment, being carried shoulder high by the players, Ali McLeod, the manager of the team, the irrepressible guy, the man who's brought this great success to Pittodrie, wearing his red pullover and waving furiously to the fans, who have now crowned him the unofficial king of Aberdeen.
Aberdeen finished the season in third place in the league, just behind the Old Firm. But then came the bombshell. Ali McLeod was leaving to take over as Scotland manager. Chairman Dick Donald and his board looked at the options. Alex Ferguson, then showing promise at St Mirren, was considered, but the job went to Billy McNeil, the former Celtic captain who'd briefly been manager at Clyde.
Ali was not just a character. Ali was a great manager, superb manager. I know that at first hand because I followed him into the seat at Aberdeen. And I remember a lad saying to him, "You get muckle big shinty fit," which means a big pair of shoes to step into. I hope my dialect was right there. And he was right. But for me, it was my first experience of a big management job. So I realised immediately that Ali McLeod had done an awful lot of very, very good things, very sensible things. I decided that I would do it my way. So obviously, I just didn't follow on from Ali. But I didn't disturb too much many of the things he'd done, because they were excellent, they were very good.
McNeil's 12 months in charge were very nearly spectacularly successful. He brought in Gordon Strachan and Steve Archibald, two players who would play a major role in the next few seasons.
Gordon Strachan appealed to me because he had just a wee thing special. He could do things. He might not have been having a particularly great game, but all of a sudden, over a period of a couple of seconds, he could do something that influenced the whole game. He had that wee touch of genius about him. And I'd seen him playing as a youngster with Dundee, and I really liked the look of him. I liked the appeal of him. And I knew that Dundee were having just a little bit of a problem financially. So I thought it was the right thing to do at that particular time.
And it was under McNeil that Joe Harper finally passed Benny Yorston's goals tally.
Yeah, I remember it well. We're playing Cowdenbeath in a cup tie at Pittodrie. And I needed one goal to actually equal the record at that point, and went out and I think we beat them something like 5-1 or something like 5-0, and I scored a hat-trick that night. I actually broke it. To me, if you're going to beat a record, beat it in style, and I broke it that night in style because I went out and scored a hat-trick. And I remember the boys all taking me out after it. It was a Wednesday night game, took me out afterward and got me pretty drunk just to make it, you know, even more memorable. And we had a really good time that night.
Harper. Haven't seen much of the
top goalscorer in the Premier Division. Four and a half minutes. Joe Harper pulls one out of the bag for Aberdeen.
Harper's Aberdeen career spanned 12 years, and in two spells he scored 199 goals, many of them spectacular and memorable. He weighed in with 27 that season, but there was to be no silverware for McNeil's Dons. They lost in the League Cup third round and the Scottish Cup final to Jock Wallace's treble winners, and finally conceded the championship on the last day of the season.
Master cut across, and Ritchie had a chance there. The ball drops in. Ritchie has scored. Fullback Ritchie has scored. But is it too late for Aberdeen?
Basically, with hindsight, you know, if I had been sensible, I wouldn't have left at that particular time, because I enjoyed myself. As I say to you, it was a marvellous club, marvellous board of directors to work for, great people around about the staff as well. It was a club, and it was a year I really did enjoy. But that's life and that's history, as they say.
A bright future looked on the cards, and it was, but not under Billy McNeil. As with Eddie Turnbull 7 years previously, Aberdeen lost a manager to his spiritual home, McNeil returning to Celtic Park. A few weeks previously, Alex Ferguson had left St Mirren in controversial circumstances. He needed a club, Aberdeen needed a manager. The rest is history.
The first season under Fergie was to be one of transition, of consolidation, of the new manager finding his feet and building relationships with the players he would come to rely on so totally.
Have you found any reaction at all from the players with the number of changes of management they've had now over the last 2 to 3 years? Has it rubbed off at all on the players?
Well, that was the third annual talk today, the three different managers. I just made a point, I just hope there's not another one next year. But there's obviously going to be a reaction. Obviously I've got more ideas and standards, and through time this will come through to the players. But at this moment in time, there's nothing happening, I'm not changing anything.
I would say the first year was, a bit of a turmoil, because Alec coming in, he was young, he was pretty abrasive at the time. He had senior players there that he had to move on, and he was definitely keen to give the youngsters a chance. So that first year was pretty abrasive, I would say. But after that, when he got his own team on the park and he got two or three players in, then you could definitely see that he knew what he was about, he knew what he wanted to achieve, and he brought the club phenomenal success in that six-year period.
He kicked off with a 4-1 win at Tynecastle, a game which saw Jim Leighton make his Dons debut. Interestingly, the starting lineup that afternoon in August 78 contained just three players, Leighton, John McMaster and Willie Miller, who would less than 5 years later beat Real Madrid to claim European glory. Joe Harper and Steve Archibald formed a prolific partnership, bagging 50 goals between them. There were some decent performances, the highlight being a Premier record 8-0 win over Motherwell, then bossed by Ali McLeod of all people, and Aberdeen finished in fourth place.
Taken by Miller, but slashed that one a wee bit. Archibald nicely down, first time to Kennedy. Kennedy looking for Strachan, Harper turning it on, is it too far? Strachan chipping it across, goal, chance for Davidson, and a great save by McLeod over the line! It's a goal, Davidson scores! Disaster for Peter McCoy. Duncan Davidson scores!
Ferguson also led his side to a first final, but had to concede the League Cup to Rangers in a game marred by the controversial sending off of Doug Rugvey. All in all, a reasonable campaign, but one which gave little indication of the fireworks to come. The following season looked as if it was to end trophyless too. But there must have been something in the air as spring approached, and with Celtic 10 points clear, the Dons exploded into action. Veteran Drew Jarvie and youngster Andy Watson were the catalysts as Aberdeen embarked on a 14-match unbeaten run, a sequence which included two victories in the Lion's Den of Celtic Park.
What a chance for McGee, and a goal! McGee scores 45 minutes! Oh, good control by McMaster, did that beautifully, and a good ball out to Scanlon. McGee, Archibald, striking all in the centre. Scanlon checks, right foot, then left foot. There's a cross, aim for Archibald. Lashford drops it, Strachan scores. Strachan makes it 3-1. Disaster for Peter Latchford.
Alec always felt that, you know, you couldn't just be better than the Old Firm. You couldn't be 5%. It had to be something like 20% better. You know, but you had to be strong mentally. You had to be prepared to go out there and take the knocks. You knew that decisions weren't going to go for you. You knew that invariably Rangers and Celtic fans would outnumber the Aberdeen fans. It built up this kind of a inner strength within the dressing room. And everybody had it.
The Dons were now in charge and clinched the Premier Division Championship, their first title in 25 years, with a never-to-be-forgotten 5-0 thrashing of Hibernian at Easter Road. Filtered through of Celtic's goalless draw at Love Street, Alex Ferguson exploded. The thousands of Dons fans massed around the stadium were ecstatic as Ferguson raced onto the pitch to celebrate with his players. Hadn't been the easiest of starts for Fergie, but 2 years into the job, he had stamped his mark indelibly on the club. Now he could really get going.
Winning that first title at Easter Road was key, I think, to the success in the 80s. It all of a sudden gave us the real belief that we could be winners. I mean, we talked about it in the dressing room and we felt that we could do well, and certainly Alex Ferguson was a manager that always pointed this to one, and he didn't want to be runners-up, he didn't want to be second, and neither did his players. But you need to have something tangible to take that belief forward, and we had to win the title. And in winning that title, that first title, that definitely set us up, gave us a belief to go on to the great things that we achieved in the 80s. It was pretty emotional, Fergie dancing on the park, coming across and hugging in tears, and I think it spelled out how important that game was for us at the time and how important it was going to be for our belief in the future.
Oh, it was great. I think I celebrated for days after that, you know, so because the only sort of trophy I haven't won is the Scottish Cup. I've played in the Cup final against Rangers, we lost that one. So I have got a League Cup winner's medal and a League winner's medal, so I missed out in the Scottish Cup, but to win the league was a tremendous achievement for a club like Aberdeen, and obviously Dundee United done it as well. So as you can see nowadays, it's a lot more difficult nowadays, but to do it back there in 1980 was tremendous.
I took it kind of in my stride, believe it or not, because I'd come from successful boys club football and I thought it was just, you know, natural to keep on winning, and especially when you find yourself in a team with such great talent and some fantastic individuals as human beings, and it just felt natural. But when I look back and I see the pictures and I see the manager's reaction and Bobby Clark's reaction, the older players, they went really ballistic, and I thought, now looking back, I can see why that meant so much to the players. And so much to Alex Ferguson, and trying to overturn the Old Firm dominance.
His first task was to bring in Archie Knox as his assistant, replacing Pat Stanton. Steve Archibald was sold to Spurs for a club record £800,000, and injury ended Joe Harper's glorious career, with his only appearance coming against Kilmarnock on the final day of the season.
I'm sure somebody's missed a goal out somewhere, because I'm sure I was always under the impression I'd scored 243 goals. So maybe there's a few goals going. Maybe I counted practice matches and friendlies, etc., and some European games, etc. But yeah, I think 199 goals, 200 always sounds better. But you know, it just leaves that one goal of a challenge for somebody else to come in and try and beat it. As I don't think anybody will. But no, 199 goals is a fair reflection.
Joey may have gone, but the quest for honours continued. There was the European Cup to consider. Mark McGee's goal proved enough to oust Austria Memphis over two legs and set up a showdown with the all-conquering English champions Liverpool. Thousands of fans queued up overnight to secure tickets for the home leg, but Liverpool won 1-0 in a game marred by Ray Kennedy's outrageous challenge on John McMaster. A fortnight later, and with Liverpool 2-0 up at half-time, came Drew Jarvie's famous rallying cry. Three quick goals and we're right back in this. But the Dons were torn apart. A 4-0 defeat on the night was embarrassing, but it did teach the players a few lessons for the future. Try as they might in the other cup competitions, there was no silverware forthcoming. And the league campaign was to fizzle out too. They finished 7 points adrift of Celtic. It was season 81-82 when everything began to fall into place. Alex Ferguson brought in Peter Weir from St Mirren in a £300,000 deal. The Leighton Miller-McLeish triumvirate began to show its undoubted worth. Gordon Strachan was back fully fit, and the kids made the breakthrough. Neil Cooper, Neil Simpson, Eric Black and John Hewitt all made significant contributions, backed up by more experienced colleagues like Stuart Kennedy, Mark McGee and Pittodrie's new cult hero, Doug Rugby.
There's a few younger players at the time who, in Alex's point of view, were good enough and he felt that they could maybe take him and put him into certain games during the season, and he knew that us guys wouldn't let him down, you know. With Alex, I mean, he didn't accept second best, you know, and he managed to get this across to us very quickly when he came to Pittodrie, you know, and if he felt that you weren't a winner, then you were out the door, basically, you know. So we quickly learned that to play for Alex Ferguson, you had to give your all and you had to be a winner.
They faced a steep learning curve. The league campaign, though, began dismally with back-to-back defeats at the hands of Dundee United and Celtic. There was a revival, but a run of six games without a win during the winter months put paid to Aberdeen's title hopes. The lessons learned 12 months previously were put to good use in Europe, where the Dons gained revenge against the English by beating Ipswich Town in a thrilling first-round tie. John Hewitt scored in the 1-1 draw at Portman Road to make Aberdeen favourites, but Bobby Robson was still making confident noises when Ipswich arrived in the north-east. Gordon Strachan and John Wark swapped first-half penalties before Peter Weir took centre stage with an explosive double.
Call is after him, but Strachan released the ball perfectly there for Peter Weir, taking on Mick Mills. And a goal! Weir the scorer, Aberdeen in the lead again. Cooper, the unhappy job of picking the ball out of the net. And here's how it happened once more. He took on Mick Mills superbly, cut inside, unleashed a shot, wide of the diving Cooper, into the back of the Ipswich net. Well, this is Weir now. And another goal! Well, that really does finish it off for Ipswich before the substitute, Callaghan, has a chance even to touch the ball. That surely makes it safe. Well, he scored one almost identical, in fact, the second goal, having a go at Mills, putting it into that corner of the net. Kennedy playing the long ball, and a chance now for Simpson. Surely it's a chance for him. Brought down, and another penalty. Yes, it was inside the box.
Strachan even had a last-minute penalty saved as the Dons ran riot. The 3-1 success posted notice that Aberdeen had arrived on the big stage.
What a dramatic finish. A glorious night for Aberdeen.
Plenty of urgency about the player, Peter Weir. Well, McMaster on that excellent left foot, and the goalkeeper struggling. And Strachan gives Aberdeen the perfect start. Maluza beaten comfortably by Kennedy. Now here's McGee. And that's come back in. And a marvellous goal by Peter Weir. McMaster again. Sweeping ahead towards Hewitt. The perfect header.
A 3-0 home win set the Dons up for their second round beating of Romanians Arjes Pitești, and clinched a meeting with SV Hamburg, Franz Beckenbauer and all. Defensive blunders proved costly in the home leg, and the 3-2 advantage looked vulnerable. So it proved, as the Germans romped to a 3-1 win in the second encounter. But Aberdeen had at least made it through two rounds of European competition for the first time ever.
Oh, it's so loose. Yes! Beautifully struck away, 2-1, if ever Aberdeen deserved a goal. Kennedy. There's no offside, Rigby. And that must be yes! Hewitt. 3-1.
And the Scottish Cup was to provide more excitement. John Hewitt scored the competition's fastest ever goal in 9.6 seconds to beat Motherwell in the third round.
A really fine atmosphere here at Fir Park, typical cup tie atmosphere. And although the pitch is a little soft on top, reasonably good, there's a great chance for Hewitt, and he scored! John Hewitt! Well, that must go down surely as the quickest Scottish Cup goal I've ever seen anyway.
And Hewitt also got the only goal, as Celtic were disposed of in the next round. A battling Kilmarnock were finally seen off 4-2 in the quarter-finals, and in a night of torrential rain, Aberdeen edged out St Mirren 3-2 in a Dens Park replay to reach the final. It was to be a most dramatic occasion. Significantly, it was Alex Ferguson's first final victory over the Old Firm. Even more significantly, it gained Aberdeen entry to the following season's European Cup Winners' Cup.
Just to watch McGee's on the bank.
Well, the cup final goal was you know, personal, a really personal memory, a real highlight personally. I know that I've always been one for the team, but that's one that, you know, I'll really cherish personally. And in the week of cup finals, Alec Ferguson used to take us to Cruden Bay on the Wednesday. Cruden Bay was a wee fishing hamlet north of Aberdeen, and we would train in the morning and we'd play nine holes of golf in the afternoon. He broke up the week. He always believed it was better for the players to be, the group of players to be together for the whole week to, you know, enhance the spirit and make sure that we were all focused and ready. So training at Cruden Bay in the morning, it was, I think, a wee five-a-side game, and I curled one into the top corner. And I don't think that I actually said I wouldn't mind one like that in the cup final, but when I scored from a very similar position in the cup final, and probably the goal in the final was even more spectacular, then the Cruden Bay memory came flooding back, and the wind was taken out of my sails, however, when the chairman, Dick Donald, fantastic man, asked me if it was meant to be a cross after the game. So I can assure Mr. Donald, the late Mr. Donald, that it wasn't the case.
There was a belief that this squad led by Alex Ferguson was on the threshold of something truly spectacular. The sense of anticipation was spine tingling. And yes, dreams do come true. Season 82-83 was to prove the most dramatic, most exciting and most successful campaign in the club's long and proud history.
And Peter Weir, off on a run on the left.
Rangers were disposed of 1-0 at Ibrox in November as the Dons embarked on a run of just one loss in 22 matches. Aberdeen were scoring freely with McGee, Black and Strachan regularly on target. United were thrashed 5-1 and St Mirren 4-0 in November. Around Christmas and New Year, there were five straight wins without a goal conceded, another 5-1 victory against Motherwell in February, and successive 5-0 wins over Kilmarnock and Hibernian to round off the season. And while the goals were flowing, Leighton, Miller and McLeish stood firm. It was the foundation on which future success was to be built.
We had what I would say was a telepathic understanding. Without doubt, myself and Alec had that. The three of us together had it. But it was simple, and most great achievements are simple. And Jim Leighton basically stayed in his line. Wasn't allowed to come off his line. I made sure that happened. And Big Alec used to go and rough them up and win everything there. That's why, you know, nowadays he's looking much rougher than me. And I didn't do anything in the partnership. I just basically pulled the strings and made sure that these two in particular did what I wanted them to do. And my job was made so easy.
Willie really was the strength of the three of us when we initially started. And it's not something you want to do, was to get on the wrong side of Willie, especially if he thought he was right, which was probably more than not. But, you know, eventually Alec and I came up, hopefully, to the standard that Willie came up to. And we had a great relationship, both for our club and our country, for probably, what, about 8 years. So, I mean, the three of us had a really good working relationship as well as off the pitch. So, yeah, it was great to play in that team with, hopefully, the three of us were, you know, a sort of foundation for the rest of the boys with Flair, such as Strachan and Weir and all the rest of it, to go and do their bit. But I think we were, you know, a strong foundation to start off with.
The Dons, though, fell agonisingly 1 point short of champions Dundee United in the tightest title race in years.
He's giving it straight to Simpson this time, a chance for Aberdeen on the break. It's Eric Black, he's got McGee on the right, a chance for Aberdeen. Still for Eric Black. The goal which will surely win the cup for Aberdeen.
The Scottish Cup, however, returned to Pittodrie for a second successive year. Hibernian, Dundee, Partick Thistle and Celtic were swept aside before Eric Black's extra-time header saw off Rangers at Hampden. It's a mark of Alex Ferguson that just when you'd expect him to be savouring another trophy, he launched a blistering attack against his team.
Alex Ferguson, many congratulations winning the Scottish Cup for the second year, but it was close.
The luckiest team in the world. They were a disgrace of performance.
Were you surprised by the way that Rangers played?
Miller McQuish won a cup for Aberdeen. Miller McQuish played Rangers themselves. A disgrace of performance. And I'm okay in winning cups, doesn't matter. Their standards have been set long ago and we're not going to accept that from any Aberdeen team. There's no way can we take any glory from it.
And that just 10 days after the finest day in the club's history. The 11th of May, 1983. The venue, the Ullevi Stadium in the Swedish city of Gothenburg. The opposition, the mighty Real Madrid. It was a night of unimaginable drama, the culmination of an adventure which began on a balmy August evening at Pittodrie and led the Dons through Switzerland, Albania, Poland, West Germany and Belgium to the ultimate triumph in the rain.
Great times at Pittodrie, some fantastic games. Probably the one that sticks out most in my mind is the Bayern Munich quarter final tie that we played here. Quite magnificent, the atmosphere that evening. Pittodrie not noted for its atmosphere, but I'll tell you what, that was some night, and I think everyone that was there on that evening will always remember that one.
Strachan Stroll, played in by McGee. Norm Miller. This is Kennedy on the touchline. Breaks for Cooper, now McGee. That's a great cross, Eric Black is there. It's off the line, now it's played in by
Simpson, and Aberdeen are level.
Last time I had a chat with Strachan.
Well, they couldn't agree, obviously. Strachan plays it in. The header finds the net. And Aberdeen are back in the match once more. Alec McLeish. Alec McLeish gives Aberdeen a chance. What a great goal it was. Now, just watch this free kick, and if you think for 1 minute that Strachan and McMaster were in any kind of confusion, you're wrong. They were doing this quite deliberately. It was a carefully rehearsed piece of tomfoolery to deceive the German defence, and it worked. Strachan went back, took the free kick, but Leish stretched those neck muscles, and Müller couldn't keep it out. So Alec McLeish picks up only his second goal of the season, but it gives Aberdeen the urge to force the pace in the last 13 minutes. Can they make it? There's Eric Black. The goalkeeper knocks it out. It's in the net, and Aberdeen are in front. Sean Hewitt. Petardre goes berserk.
Never forget, because my wife had actually said to me prior to the game that don't worry, you'll come on and you'll score a winning goal, you know. And I think it was Johnny had flighted a fantastic ball up towards Eric in the box. Eric got up really well, headed it towards goal. And I was taught with Alec and Archie that to follow things in, you know, all good strikers follow things in, because you never know if the ball's going to spill back off the goalkeeper. And at the time, I think the goalkeeper got caught in two minds whether to either parry it over the bar or to try and catch it, and he did neither, and he ended up knocking it back down into my path. And fortunately for me, as I came running in, I was actually in maybe too early, and my standing foot and my right foot actually slipped from underneath me, but I still managed to get my left foot round the ball and basically just guide it on target, and I went through the goalkeeper's legs, and this is a sailor S history. So a very, very special moment for me that I'll never forget.
There's Ford Dekkers. And the score against Scotland, playing for Belgium in 1979, the European Championship. Here's Dougie Bell. Well, that's the kind of skill Aberdeen wanted to introduce to the match. A great chance for Bell. And Black gives Aberdeen the perfect start. Here's Bell again. Well, the Belgians have never seen Bell play before tonight, and they certainly have learned a lot about his close control and running power. Here's Simpson, going all the way himself. Neil Simpson.
I think I actually beat three players, but as the years went on, I keep on adding a player, so it's up to about 10 now. But I really enjoyed that moment, especially at score, like in the semi-final, the cup. You know, you can see the supporters sort of right. I'm getting closer to the goal, they're rising. I'm a wee bit closer, they're going a wee bit further, and then when I actually scored it, it was just unbelievable. You know, you can see the crowd going absolutely crazy. And the atmosphere was, especially on a European night, it was great.
Rugby now finding Bell. Kleister's coming across. Mark McGee! Twenty-third minute of the match. Alec Ferguson on the track to make a change, perhaps, greeting the third Aberdeen goal, perhaps the most vital one of all. Yeah, Jensen now trying to recover. The header into the corner, and Peter Weir makes it four. Strachan turning away from his marker, a great chance for Aberdeen. It's off the line, and still it won't go in. It's made it at last. Mark McGee takes the credit. 6 minutes left for play. Well, that took a long time to sneak over the line. Hewitt put it in, Strachan shrugged off Kleister's, took it towards the goalkeeper, tempted him out of his goal, played it across for McGee. It was blocked brilliantly in the line by Bielusch, blocked again, McGee once more, Müller came forward, and McGee on the ground got the last touch.
14,000 Aberdeen fans made their way to Gothenburg, many on the ferry St Clair, others by road, rail and air. It was an occasion not to be missed, one which every Don supporter who made it there will never forget. Alex Ferguson invited Jock Steen to travel with a party and spent the days before the final convincing each and every member of the squad that Madrid could be beaten. And so it proved.
Strachan playing a good shot. Oh, against the crossbar and knocked down there by Eric Black. A tremendous strike for Aberdeen. And young Black, only 19 years old, caught that spectacularly on the volley. And Strachan waits patiently to take this corner then for Aberdeen. Black, McGee, Cooper, Simpson, Weir and Rugby are all in there for Aberdeen, and McLeish has come up late, and the goal is there, and it's given by Black. Aberdeen ahead inside 7 minutes. Well, it was McLeish's late run that did it in.
Well, Alex Ferguson was telling me yesterday at the hotel that they were working on this, you know, coming in late on free kicks and corner kicks. And you can see the space that McLeish had. They ran from very deep. The ball breaks lovely, and there's Eric Black to finish him off. What a tremendous start for Aberdeen.
Well, he's hit the crossbar, and now he scored. There's McLeish's header, and suddenly Black, the 19-year-old, is in there, and Aberdeen are in the lead. Oh, a bad back pass, and a penalty. A disaster there for Aberdeen. Juanito has a golden opportunity of putting Real Madrid back at 1-1. And that's what it is. Up gets Cooper. On its way by Black. A difficult bounce there for Metgod, and he was fooled by it. And McGee finds Strachan, and Metgod was snapping at him. And now Weir. Just want a long ball towards McGee, but it may be too delayed now. Cooper. Well, it's time now that they've got everybody back, except that Rugby's right in there. And that could have been a problem for the Real Madrid goalkeeper, Big Doug Rugby, who made a really late run. He's 6'2", this goalkeeper 6'4". It really was a battle of giants there as the Aberdeen fullback came in. Whack. Ooh, played in for Stielicke, played on towards Santillana, and that was an important interception there by Rugby. And here's Strachan. Back for McGee, back for Strachan. Weir in a bit of space on the far side. Now, we need him maybe to beat this man and get a cross in. He's well done part of it. And Strachan, he banged it against the goalkeeper's legs, and the keeper knew nothing about it. That could so easily, if that had gone even a foot either side of the keeper, there would have been absolutely no stopping it. Now to take this corner, Peter Weir for Aberdeen. And Black with the header! Just kept out. Weir once more with the cross for Aberdeen. Good spell this, it didn't come to Black, it comes for Strachan. And it might go yet, and in the end, Real Madrid, living so dangerously in their six-yard area, just managed to get the ball to the goalkeeper's hands, and Aberdeen twice in a couple of minutes could so easily have been 2-1 into the lead. And they're doing a pretty good hustling job at the moment, our Aberdeen. And a skillful one as well, as Peter Weir takes it up. Now he's got McGee up there and he's got Black up there. He's got Strachan coming up quickly as well. And he's gone past another one as Weir. The cross comes in, they're all over the place, and Black with the header is over the top. Oh, he'll be furious about that because he is normally, Eric Black, such a good header of the ball, and what a brilliant run by Peter Weir. He must have taken at least four defenders, and that little flick up off the defender suddenly fell for him.
Hewitt and Rugby. Cooper and McLeish are there too. Same towards. Oh, goodness, that nearly got in.
Rugby's header.
Nito again. Juan Jose. Aberdeen have got to find some strength in those legs to hustle for a few more minutes yet. And they've done so. Weir.
That's a good ball for. From Peter Weir, and now Aberdeen with McGee making the break, and Hewitt waiting in the middle! Oh! Hewitt!
Wow.
well. What a fantastic goal. And Hewitt has done it again, coming on as a substitute. Let's hope that's a winner as well. Marvellous goal. Could have started it with the ball down the line. McGee took it on, over it came, and there was Hewitt at the back post. The Aberdeen fans are going mad behind us here. Tremendous scenes.
That's the real Peter Weir. And that's the brilliant John Hewitt. And that's 2-1 to Aberdeen. Well, if Aberdeen survive this, they've almost certainly won the cup, but can they survive it? And who's behind it this time? Salguero's there. It looks as though it might be a blast at goal. It can't really be anything else. And the referee wants the Aberdeen wall back another couple of yards. Salguero with the blast! Right past the post! When I saw that go past the keeper, I thought for one horrible moment it was going into the corner of the Aberdeen net. But no, it's past the post as Jim Leighton went flying across his goal. And Aberdeen are almost there. On my watch, there are 5 seconds of extra time remaining. All they've got to do is just keep their heads for a second or two more. They've done it! Aberdeen have won the Cup Winners' Cup by 2-1. Eric Black and a brilliant headed goal by John Hewitt. The goal scorers for Aberdeen. And Juanito from the penalty spot for Real Madrid.
The final whistle signalled outpourings of relief and joy and sparked celebrations the like of which had never before been experienced by the Red Army.
A brilliant battling performance in the most appalling conditions by Aberdeen. As at this moment, Willie Miller, an excellent captain on a difficult night. And there's the other captain, and that's the other side of the story, of course. But that's the happy side, with Aberdeen winning their first European trophy. And the way they're managed and administered, you have the feeling it won't be the last.
Alec Ferguson's the end of a marvellous night. The fans are singing. Oh. How do you feel about it all?
I can't, honestly, it's just hit me. It's the greatest moment of my life. But I'll tell you, it was a magnificent performance. On the conditions, I thought we thoroughly deserved it. They're the ones that did it. The players out there, proud of them. It's a team performance.
Alec, what about the fans? They're singing here behind me. They're going mad.
I love them.
Eric Black and John Hewitt did a marvellous amount of work here tonight. You must have been proud of them coming through something like
well,
this.
Well, an experience in itself to come to a European Cup final so young. What can you say about it? I mean, they showed experience at times, the enthusiasm okay at times, but oh, it was marvellous.
A few celebrations coming up now, Alec.
What an ass is going to be, believe me.
Alec, marvellous. Everyone in Britain, I'm sure, is proud of you.
Thank you.
All the best.
Thanks.
The fans were fantastic. They gave us the vocal backing right from the start of the match, right the way through. And to actually go on and win the game, it was just a great night for them. I mean, as I say, it's one that every Aberdeen fan who was lucky enough to get to Gothenburg, I'm sure will cherish for the rest of life.
And if it was magnificent for the fans, we can only begin to imagine what it must have been like to be on the park and to score the winning goal.
Initially, great play from Peter Weir, deep in, our left, in the left-hand side of the park. Peter beat about two or three players, then played a great ball up the line to Mark. And I was basically just watching Mark and at the same time heading towards goal, you know, because I wasn't sure if Mark was going to beat the fullback and come inside or if he was going to play the early cross, you know. And I was sort of advancing towards the goal, watching Mark and looking at the goal because basically I had no marker to lose, you know. It was just myself, the goal and the goalkeeper. And I just kept that eye on Mark and the other eye watching the goalkeeper. And sure enough, Mark whipped in an early cross and I could just see the goalkeeper standing on his goal line and I'm saying to myself, he's not coming for his cross, you know. And by the time he did decide to move to come for the cross, the ball had actually passed him and it was just basically a case of watching the ball coming and let it hit in my head and into the back of the goal. I really couldn't miss.
And Hewitt waiting in the middle! Hewitt!
I remember picking myself up, rubbing my hands in my shirt, you know, and I didn't know what to do. I was lost, and it's still to this day I get a lot of stick for the boys, you know, about this so-called star jump that I did, and I just sort of run away towards the side, and I remember Big Doogie coming tearing up the park and basically wrestling me to the ground, you know, and it was just fantastic feeling, and Obviously, there was still a bit of time to go in the game, you know, and we were sort of holding on. And I think it was in the last minute of the game, they got a free kick just outside of our box, and I was standing in the wall and I kept saying to myself, please God, don't let them score, you know. And when the guy actually had the shot, it sort of flew past us, and I just remember sort of turning around and looking at the goal, and it just shaved the back post, and I thought, oh. And then after that, the referee blew for time, and it was just fantastic, it really was fantastic.
After the game, you know, the lads are really cock-a-hoop in the dressing room, and the champagne's flowing freely. And I remember hovering in the showers longer than everybody else, probably because I was feeling a bit sorry for myself, the mistake I made, and rather than seeing the bigger picture. You know, I was a wee bit selfish maybe. And this was a phenomenal triumph, really, and you know, forget the mistake. You know, when I think about it now, maybe it was meant to be for us to win the cup. And I think that's a more positive way to look at it. But anyway, Alec Ferguson came into the shower, fully clothed, I may add. And he stood there as I kind of stood with my head down, and he says, look, you've come through personal triumph there. He says, you made a mistake in a major final. He says, but the way you played after that, he says, a lot of people would have went to pieces. And, you know, those words certainly helped, absolutely.
I think it was only really later on when you really look back on it and reflect on it and you see what we actually achieved. See, it's hard to explain how we felt, but I remember going down to the last Cup Winners' Cup final, and there was a representative from each team on the pitch and at Villa Park. And on my right-hand side, I had Alan Simonson from Barcelona, who'd won it in 82. And I had a Juventus player on my left-hand side who won it in 84, so that really just summed up, you know, the level that we'd actually played at.
At the time, to be honest, we just looked on it as another final that we're in. I don't think we realised the importance of the occasion. Perhaps the approach and the attitude of Alec Ferguson and Archie Knox and the build-up to that helped us keep our feet firmly on the ground. But you know, I can, you know, look back and sincerely say that it was just another trophy to us. Although trophies were important, I don't think we realised the importance of this one in particular. It was only after the game and when we came back, and when it hit me was going through the streets in Aberdeen through Union Street, and it was absolutely amazing. I mean, I'd never witnessed so many people on Union Street for a start, and you just didn't realise how it had taken hold of the city, and that's when it first struck us. And then from then on, when you look back and think, I'm only one of three captains in Scotland that's actually lifted a European trophy, then I think that says it all, and it is a very, very special moment.
Gothenburg was vindication of Alex Ferguson's tactics and belief, of his ability to spot a player, his ability to mould a team, of his unquenchable will to win. Even 20 years later, it's hard to believe that a team from the northeast of Scotland so outplayed the legendary Real Madrid. But it happened, and Aberdeen have the silverware to prove it. It was always going to be hard to follow 82-83, but Ferguson was determined to build on success. He rejected the chance to manage boyhood heroes Rangers, instead signing a new five-year contract at Pittodrie, and set about making life yet more difficult for the old firm. With Billy Stark and Stuart McKimmy added to the squad, Aberdeen romped through the early stages of the League Cup, Eric Black scoring four in a 9-0 demolition of Raith Rovers along the way. And the title challenge looked strong, just a couple of defeats in the first 4 months of the campaign. There was also progress in Europe, a struggle against Akranes, but an aggregate 3-2 success over the Icelanders, followed by an eventual comfortable win against Beveren. Another goalless draw in Belgium set up the Dons for a 4-1 stroll at Pittodrie, Gordon Strachan helping himself to a double.
For Aberdeen, collected by Miller. Now Hewitt. McGee is up, so is Weir. Hewitt lining up the cross. There's Peter Weir, a great chance for the third. Into Strachan. And that is absolutely superb. There's Strachan. McGee made a good break on the right. Tackle from Garot, not quite decisive enough. The ball's in for Peter Weir, and that is the fourth goal.
The winter months saw a continuation of the impressive league form, as Aberdeen edged clear of Celtic and Dundee United. And in the Scottish Cup, Kilmarnock and Clyde had already been disposed of when thoughts once again turned to Europe. A 2-0 defeat in Hungary at the hands of Újpest Doza looked to have ended Aberdeen's hopes. But another dramatic Pittodrie night saw Mark McGee hit a hat-trick as the Dons swept to a 3-2 aggregate success.
That's not a bad ball, it's there! McGee, the equaliser!
Black. Here's Strachan. Must be, yes! The hat-trick! Mark McGee again. 3-0. It shall not weary him. That's into McKimmy with a shot and he scored!
A seven-game unbeaten run solidified Aberdeen's position at the top of the Premier Division. A rare McKimmy goal at Tynecastle, clinching Alex Ferguson's second title with four matches to spare. Wins over both Dundee sides moved the Dons into a third successive Scottish Cup final, but their domination of Europe was to be ended by FC Porto. The Portuguese won 1-0 at home and then repeated that scoreline at a fog-bound Pittodrie. Earlier that season, however, another European trophy found its way to the city as Aberdeen lifted the Super Cup, the annual match-up of the European Cup and Cup Winners' Cup holders. A 0-0 draw in Hamburg put the Dons in charge, and the Germans were overrun at Pittodrie as Simpson and McGee scored the goals which confirmed what all Dons fans knew anyway: Aberdeen were the best team in Europe.
Celts challenging, there's Neil Simpson.
Yes!
And Aberdeen have made it! Neil Simpson gives Aberdeen the lead 1 minute into the second half. Peter, we're happy to have Black in the box. Use his skill in the air for this corner kick. Black goes up. There's Willie Miller.
Yes!
Right in by Mark McGee. And the goal's been given. Aberdeen are two in front. So not quite a trophy, but a plaque which will have pride of place in the Pittodrie trophy room. Willie Miller holds it aloft to the Aberdeen supporters. And now the gold medals are presented to the Aberdeen players. Alec Ferguson in the background there, looking on proudly as well he might. His team proving unquestionably that they're the finest team in Europe of 1983.
The main achievement was winning at Gothenburg against Real Madrid. It's the pinnacle, but you know, to go on and then win the Super Cup against the Bundesliga team Hamburg, who yeah, I mean, the Bundesliga was the best league in the world in these days. We had beaten Bayern Munich in the quarterfinals of the Cup Winners' Cup, and now to come up against you know, the European champions, then it's just amazing to lift that trophy when you look back in that year and think what we achieved.
The season climaxed back at Hampden on the 19th of May, with Celtic this time providing the opposition. Eric Black scored first, but despite Roy Aitken sending off, Paul McStay netted a deserved late equaliser. Mark McGee volleyed in his last goal for the club to clinch an historic victory, as the Dons joined Rangers in Queen's Park as the only sides to win three successive Scottish Cup finals. The celebrations had barely died down, however, when Aberdeen's greatest ever team began to break up. Strachan, McGee and Rugvi all departed. Ferguson, though, drafted in a man he reckons could fill McGee's goal-scoring boots, Frank McDougall. Tommy McQueen was also added to the squad. McDougall found his feet quickly, and the early league form was good as the Dons racked up win after win. The striker, in fact, scored in 8 successive Premier games as the team led the table by 3 points in late November. By then, however, Aberdeen had already exited 2 competitions. An Ali McLeod-inspired Airdrie inflicted a 3-1 defeat in the League Cup, and Dinamo Berlin beat them in the European Cup on penalties. After an aggregate 3-3 draw, the Dons were 1 spot kick away from victory, but Miller and Black saw their efforts saved, and the Dons were out. The league campaign stuttered a little with 2 defeats by Dundee United, but was soon back on track as Aberdeen marauded through the second half of the season. A succession of high-scoring wins, the pick being a 5-1 demolition of Rangers, with McDougall hitting a hat-trick, set up a second successive championship.
Weir's got the cross in, and Dave McPherson got it away. But it goes again, and Frank McDougall with a header, and Aberdeen are ahead. 11 minutes gone in the first half, and Aberdeen's pressure pays off. Oh, it's a delightful ball from Eric Black. Simpson breaking on the left. McDougall is through the middle, calling for the ball now. There's McDougall! And there's Aberdeen's second. Aberdeen taking full control of the play. Derek Johnson's header there. Simpson! Turned in by McDougall! And the flag has gone up on the far side. It went up rather late, and referee David Syme has waved the flag down and insisted that the goal be given. And the Rangers players now running towards the referee to protest, but Frank McDougall is now celebrating his first hat-trick as an Aberdeen player.
That was duly wrapped up on a sunny Saturday afternoon at the end of April. Fittingly, it was heroic captain Willie Miller who headed home in the 1-1 draw with Celtic, which sparked more title celebrations.
And there goes the final whistle. The Aberdeen supporters greet their favourites. Alec Ferguson comes out of the dugout looking very happy indeed. Alec Ferguson undoubtedly demonstrating that he clearly believes the league is well and truly won, notwithstanding mathematical considerations.
So many memories, Willie, and so many famous parts of the ground for you, I suppose, but this spot or hereabouts, the spot where you scored the goal that won the title?
Yeah, that's correct. Scored the goal against Celtic that afforded us a draw to win the title that day. It was in this goal here and wasn't one of my better headers, but it was certainly accurate. I went into that corner and then I decided to go on one of these silly celebrations. I didn't have a choreographed celebration in these days, so it was all emotion, and of course we ran past the terrace in there, and I believe you were actually in the terrace.
Gave you a wave.
Day.
Gave you a wave, Willie.
And a wave back.
'85-'86 was to be Alex Ferguson's last full season as manager. Typically, it ended with another haul of silverware. Jim Bett was the only close-season purchase of note. He announced his arrival with a stunning debut goal as the champions kicked off with a 3-0 beating of Hibernian. The Dons led the league until late December, but fell away thereafter as the goals dried up and slipped back to fourth place, the club's lowest finish during the Ferguson years. The cup competitions were to prove more successful. Alex Ferguson finally got his hands on the League Cup as his team marched through 6 matches without conceding a goal. Ayr United, St Johnstone and Hearts were disposed of, and United were beaten home and away as the Dons reached the League Cup final for the first time in 6 years. Hibernian were no match for Aberdeen. Eric Black scored twice, Billy Stark the other, in a commanding 3-0 victory.
Billy Stark! 2-0 to Aberdeen. There's Simpson. Eric yes. Black. Aberdeen start. And there goes the final whistle. Aberdeen are the winners.
The Scottish Cup campaign was to be equally convincing, with only Dundee, who forced a quarter-final replay, putting up much resistance. Montrose and Arbroath were early victims, and another 3-0 win over Hibs sent the Dons back to the National Stadium. Hearts' title challenge had ended in tears of despair a week earlier, and they looked a broken team as Aberdeen dismantled their dreams. John Hewitt grabbed a double, with Stark again on target, as the Dons crushed their opponents by 3-0.
And Billy Stark, in fact, is warming up on the track below us as Aberdeen try to get forward again. Here's Peter Weir. Kidd not quite so close to him this time. Weir testing Kidd's pace. The great chance! John Hewitt! And the vital start to the second half provided by Aberdeen. Weir again. And down goes the Aberdeen winger once again, taking the ball into Walter Kidd as often as possible, forcing rash tackles. And this free kick again poses danger for the Hearts defence. Played across by Weir. Billy Stark! And that settles it! 15 minutes left to play. Henry Smith is beaten for the third time. Billy Stark ties it up surely now for Aberdeen. And there's the goal-scoring hero bringing up the rear, John Hewitt. Special cheer for him. And a delighted face, Alex Ferguson, the Aberdeen and Scotland manager. Well, it's perhaps been a season which Aberdeen felt wasn't quite as good as they'd hoped, but they've won two trophies, the Scald Cup back in October, and now the Scottish Cup.
I knew it 2-0 up. We were going to be very, very hard to beat because having a back four the way we did, you know, with McLeish and Miller, and I just knew that there wasn't many teams that could possibly score two or three goals against Aberdeen. And then when Billy scored the third goal, I knew that was the game finished, you know. So it was a great way to end the season for me on a personal note, you know, to score two goals in the cup final and to get voted man of the match for the sponsors as well. So it was good.
1986 was to be a year of departures, the most devastating of which saw the death at 60 of Chris Anderson from motor neuron disease. Chris played over 100 games for the club between 1948 and 53. He returned to join the board in 1967 and was appointed vice chairman 3 years later. Chris Anderson was a progressive and far-sighted football administrator. He played a major role in the development of Pittodrie Stadium, was one of the main architects of the new-look Premier Division and the perfect foil for Chairman Dick Donald. His death was mourned throughout football, but particularly by Dons fans all over the world.
He and Dick Donald, who was the chairman, were a perfect combination. Dick was a solid Aberdeen and a businessman, not very articulate. Chris was totally articulate. And the two of them together just played off each other and were the foundation of the success of this club, even to the extent of thinking that about employing Alec Ferguson on the week he'd got a sack from St Mirren and seemed to be in a bit of disgrace. And when he went on that League Cup final day at Hampden, just before he died, he looked around, he told me, and he knew he would never see this place again. And he went into the dressing room and he managed to face all the players except Eric Black. And they both broke down. And he said he thought Eric was the spirit of the club. He epitomised what this club was about, a clean-cut young man.
The breakup of the Gothenburg Heroes continued that summer. Eric Black left for Metz, Neil Cooper for Aston Villa, but Archie Knox returned. After less than 3 years as Dundee boss, Knox was tempted back to Pittodrie and made co-manager with Alex Ferguson. It was an arrangement which was to last just a few short months. The League Cup saw wins over Alloa and Clyde, but a penalty shootout defeat at the hands of Celtic. And by the start of November, Aberdeen had won just half of their 14 league matches, not the form of previous seasons. That month, Alex Ferguson announced that he was leaving Pittodrie for an even bigger challenge, reviving the fortunes of Manchester United. It was the end of an era, an unbelievable era in which the man from Govan had delivered an unprecedented haul of silverware. Ferguson won the League Cup once, the Scottish Cup four times, the Premier Division Championship three times, the European Cup Winners' Cup and the European Super Cup. 10 trophies in 8 years. In the 75 years before Ferguson breezed into Pittodrie, Aberdeen had won just 6 major trophies. That statistic emphasises just what Alex Ferguson meant to Aberdeen and makes him arguably the greatest don in the club's history. The next incumbent of the manager's office at Pittodrie was always going to be faced with a near impossible task, and so it proved for the chosen man, Ian Porterfield. The Fifer had enjoyed success as a player, scoring Sunderland's shock winner in the 1973 FA Cup final against Leeds United. He started well, with only one defeat in his first 16 games in charge.
Dodds waiting in the middle with Joe Miller. Good play from young Robertson, and a fine cross! Brilliantly scored by Joe Miller! And the handspring to celebrate, Joe Miller missed one golden chance early on, then missed a penalty kick, but made no mistake with the header to put Aberdeen back on level terms.
Porterfield made two big-name signings, Charlie Nicholas and his namesake Peter, and brought in a number of lesser-known players he'd encountered in English football, but he never quite got the right blend. Don's fans, accustomed to success, quickly grew impatient, and their frustration increased when they lost the 1987 League Cup final to Rangers in a penalty shootout. In spring 1988, Porterfield added Alex Smith, recently sacked by St Mirren, to his coaching staff, and when the manager resigned shortly afterwards, the Aberdeen board didn't have far to look for his replacement. In June, Smith was named as co-manager along with Jockey Scott, tempted away from Dundee, and another Dons legend, Drew Jarvie, was installed as coach. The new management team, like Porterfield, tasted bitter defeat at the hands of Rangers in the League Cup final, 3-2 this time in another thrilling contest. Jim Leighton had by then followed Alex Ferguson to Old Trafford, and Smith turned to Holland for his successor. Theo Snelders made an instant impact and was joined at Pittodrie by Scouser Paul Mason, who'd also been plying his trade in the Dutch league. Smith didn't finish there. Using his contacts in Holland to secure with varying degrees of success, Peter van de Ven, Theo ten Cat, Willem van der Ark and, most spectacularly of all, Hans Heelhuis, a record £650,000 signing from PSV Eindhoven. Heelhuis kicked off with a debut double against Dunfermline and followed that with a stunning midweek winner against Rangers. In fact, his form was reflected in the opening to the season, which saw only one defeat in the first dozen league matches. Then, towards the end of October, the Dons had collected their first silverware in the post-Fergie era, Mason scoring both goals in a 2-1 League Cup final win over Rangers, a game in which Smith audaciously fielded a relatively unknown youngster by the name of Ian Jess.
Encouraging bit of play that from Ian, giving the wall back, the full 10 yards. Nicholas is there, Connor is there, Bett is there. All of them have scored from free kicks outside the box. There's Connor, lofting it in. The header from Mason! Aberdeen are ahead! So just 2 minutes remaining in the first period of extra time as David Robertson launches the long throw into the box. Van der Ark got a touch, there's Nicholas. It's back to Mason! 2-1 to Aberdeen, Jockey Scott on the track. And the long throw did all the damage. David Robertson launching that ball and Van der Ark gets a vital touch on. Nicholas tees it up there for Mason and he drills home the goal, which puts Aberdeen ahead. There's Willie Miller, for the third time he's won the League Cup. The loser twice in a row against Rangers. The first time in 5 finals against Rangers that Aberdeen have been victorious in the League Cup final. The Scull Cup winners are Aberdeen with Alex Smith, the manager, smiling happily. It's his first trophy in charge at Aberdeen.
It became apparent early in the new year that Aberdeen were out of the title race, but they battled through to the Scottish Cup final by accounting for Partick, Morton, Hearts and, in a 4-0 semi-final thrashing, Dundee United. The final against Celtic was less than memorable over 120 minutes as the tie ended 0-0. But the fireworks then exploded in one of Hampden's most dramatic showdowns in years. Charlie Nicholas, already lined up for a summer return to Celtic Park, scored to send the penalty shootout into sudden death. Snelder's save from Anton Rogan, and Brian Irvine in for the injured Willie Miller, smashed home the decider. The Dons had won the cup 9-8 on penalties.
It's Brian Irvine who wins the cup in the end for Aberdeen. The big central defender is mobbed by his teammates after that finishing effort. So too is Theo Snelder's.
The following day, as Alex Smith led his team into the townhouse for an official reception, one fan called out, "Next year, the treble." Even though Smith had secured a cup double, it was an indication that the domination under Alex Ferguson wouldn't quickly be forgotten. The job of Aberdeen manager now brought with it previously unimagined demands. The treble may have been a pipe dream, but Smith very nearly guided his team to a first championship in 6 years.
Well, no flag going up against Mason, inside the penalty area. Oh, a tremendous goal by Paul Mason. And that is a special goal, not just for Paul Mason, but for Aberdeen, because that is the 100th league goal the Dons have scored here at Celtic Park.
Rangers looked to have the title in their grasp, but the Dons put together an amazing unbeaten run, and when, on the penultimate Saturday of the season, their rivals lost 3-0 at Motherwell, Aberdeen hit the top of the table.
Aberdeen, and it's Ian Jess, the man who has been a scourge to Celtic this season. 19 minutes gone. Aberdeen 1, Celtic 0.
The final game was to be an Ibrox showdown, and the Dons needed just a draw. Michael Watt had to be drafted in for the injured Snelders, and Mark Hatley twice clattered the young keeper. Van de Ven and Heelhouse spurned first-half chances before a Hatley double denied Aberdeen. A magnificent campaign ended in tears. The following season, 91-92, was to be a difficult one, punctuated by a string of indifferent results, and the fans weren't slow to vent their fury. The board waited until the turn of the year, and with little sign of improvement, they gave the supporters what they wanted. Alex Smith became the first manager ever to be sacked by Aberdeen, and the legendary Willie Miller was named as his replacement.
Something that I've been building up to over the years. Obviously, once you get over 30, you start looking towards the future. And I would like to think that I've tried to build on the future by doing the coaching course at Lars and by getting experience with Aberdeen. So that experience will stand me in good stead, I'm sure.
Miller took stock, signed the likes of Duncan Shearer, Miksu Patilainen, Lee Richardson and later Billy Dodds, and was so very nearly successful. While Rangers lifted the treble that first year, Miller's Aberdeen collected a treble of runners-up places. They lost 2-1 to Rangers in the League Cup final, by a similar scoreline in the Scottish Cup final, and fell just short in the title race. That was to be just about as close as the Dons came to lifting a trophy under the man who'd achieved legendary status as a player. Ultimately, though, Willie Miller couldn't provide the sheen of silverware, and after 3 years in the Pittodrie hot seat, the unthinkable happened. Aberdeen sacked him.
3 years here. Two particularly successful years, although only time will tell how you're judged as a manager. But the first 2 years were... The first year in particular was very successful, finishing second in the league and getting to two cup finals. But for me, it wasn't good enough. You know, being second has never been good enough for me. In year two, you know, we worked away again and wasn't quite as successful as the previous year. But we still finished second in the league behind a very, very successful Rangers side who were doing extremely well in Europe. But it was a disappointing third season and we parted company. I can't maybe say in good terms, but you know, that's football for you, and football management, these things happen. But you know, I enjoyed my time as manager here. I think I can look back with a lot of satisfaction. You get a lot of satisfaction by watching some of the young players that you coached and worked with coming through, and there's a number of them now coming through at Pittodrie under Eb Skodal. And that gives you a big kick, because it's not always easy to do a full day's work and then go out and coach them in a pouring cold Thursday night over in the car park. But as manager, I felt that was part of the job, and it's a part of the job that even now, looking back, gives me an awful lot of satisfaction.
By the time Miller left, the face of Pittodrie Stadium had been transformed once again with the unveiling of the magnificent Richard Donald stand, named after the club's long-serving chairman.
We were very proud, obviously, because it had my father's name on it, and I think it was very justified because he'd put his life into Aberdeen Football Club. But the fact that we had a purpose-built facility was something that we always wanted to do, and we had dining facilities, box facilities, and also catering facilities and toilet facilities that we were proud for our supporters.
The board immediately installed Miller's assistant, Roy Aitken, as successor. An early Pittodrie win over Rangers boosted Aitken's stock, but he also had to suffer perhaps the club's biggest embarrassment, a Scottish Cup exit at the hands of second division Stenhouse Muir. Relegation looked in the cards. The situation seemed desperate with just a handful of games remaining. But a win against Hearts helped, and a 2-0 beating of nearest rivals Dundee United saw the Dons off the foot of the table with just 1 week to go. A final day victory at Falkirk staved off the automatic drop, and a convincing playoff win against Dunfermline, 6-2 in aggregate, preserved Aberdeen's top flight status. A great servant left that summer, Alex McLeish departing after 18 years. But another great servant remained to continue his remarkable contribution, a man who's been with the club for almost half its history.
Terry Scott at Aberdeen Football Club is known as something of an institution. And if there's one thing that he taught me that I feel is very important in this football world is humility. He kept us on the right track, and a lot of players will look back and say that Teddy Scott helped, as well as Alec Ferguson, as well as Ali McLeod, the great managers of the past in Aberdeen. Teddy helped to shape and develop their careers and their lives.
Roy Aitken was confirmed as manager on a permanent basis, rallied the side, and for a time it looked promising. The Dons finally recaptured some silverware. Shearer and Dodds on target in the League Cup final triumph over Dundee.
That's McKimmy, former Dundee player also. Good running by Glass, great ball in! So Joe Miller at the start of the second half, wide on the right-hand side. So Aberdeen ringing the tactical changes in that sense. Here's Stephen Glass on the left, an excellent first half. Oh, great sleight of foot there. Duncan Shearer, 2-0 to Aberdeen. And once again, the creator was 19-year-old Stephen Glass.
The following December, Aberdeen hit the heady heights of second place in the league with victory at Tynecastle. But it was all to prove another false dawn, and Aberdeen finished sixth in the 10-team league. The slide continued, and just under a year later, a 5-0 drubbing at the hands of Dundee United in November 97 saw the end of Aitken's reign, and Stuart Milne turned to the former Hibernian boss, Alex Miller. But crisis management turned once again to a manager crisis. Miller had a reputation for putting out less than exciting sides and was expected to solidify a leaky defence. It never worked out for Alex Miller at Pittodrie, and he infuriated many fans by selling favourite Billy Dodds to Dundee United in a deal which saw Robbie Winters move in the opposite direction. Again, relegation looked on the cards, And after little more than a year in the job, Miller became the next casualty in the manager's office. This time the job went to Miller's assistant, the popular Paul Hegarty. And with little resources to work with, Hegarty did what was asked of him. He kept the Dons in the SPL. The board had always said they would review the situation at the end of the season, and while appreciative of Paul Hegarty's efforts, they didn't give him the job. Instead, the post went to an experienced manager, one who'd enjoyed considerable success in the continent. For the first time, Aberdeen appointed a foreign manager, the Dane Ebbe Skodal. The fans were about to welcome a new cult hero.
I remember going to a birthday, where Mark Reber was there as well. And I always remember he said, because then it was publicized and it was out that I was the next manager in Aberdeen, and he said, are you sure you know what you're going into there? And I said, yeah, I know that they have struggled for some years, and I also know something about the history from the 80s where Alex Ferguson was here. So, of course, I know it's a big club. And it's a big challenge as well, but I'm up for it because I also think I need to try something else now.
The former Bromby boss didn't rush into the transfer market. Goalkeeper David Priest is only summer signing, but was given an indication of the task which lay in store when Celtic crushed the Dons 5-0 on the opening day of the season. There followed a record-breaking run of defeats. It was 6.5 games before Aberdeen even scored a goal. But that was put right in a stunning 6-5 success at Motherwell. Skodal brought new faces in. Solberg, Gundfeit, Stavrum, Belabed and Zedou Ali. But the die had been cast in terms of the SPL, and the Dons finished that season bottom, spared relegation only by league reconstruction. The Cups were a different story. Wins over Livingston and Falkirk were followed by a memorable beating of Rangers, and Aberdeen reached the League Cup final with a 1-0 victory over Dundee United. Sadly, there was to be no happy ending, as Celtic lifted the trophy with a 2-0 win. The Scottish Cup campaign was also progressing. Replays were required to finish off St Mirren and Inverness Cali Thistle. Dundee United were beaten in the quarter-finals, and in a superb comeback, Hibernian defeated in the semi-final. The final was to be legend Jim Leighton's last game for the club, but he was cruelly injured in the opening minutes, and with Robbie Winters between the posts, Rangers cruised to a 4-0 success.
The crowning glory was to be the Scottish Cup final. I remember talking to you, I think the night before or two nights before, and just about the last thing you said to me was, I'm going to be the last person off that pitch. Didn't quite work out that way.
No, I've been reminded of that a few times since. Sometimes these things come back to haunt you when you say things like that. But I mean, more or less everybody knew it was going to be my last game, and you couldn't really handpick a better way to finish your career than to play in the Scottish Cup final at Hampden, having had so much success there, you know, in my career with Aberdeen before. So it was a major disappointment. Not exactly the scenario that I had dreamt about the night before, but these things happen in football, and there's nothing you can do about it.
A lot of people say that it was a disaster the first year, but that's normally the people who forget that we qualified for both cup finals the first year, which I think is quite an achievement to do that. We didn't manage to win any of them, but with a little luck, because Rangers was in that final, FA final, We managed to qualify for Europe there as well.
The fans were right behind Ebbe, their faith unshaken by the UEFA Cup exit at the hands of Irish side FC Bohemian. But the league form was little improved that second season. There was also an early exit from the League Cup, and the Scottish Cup run was halted in the fourth round by Livingston. By early 2001, however, there were signs of improvement. Ebbe had begun to blood some of the club's promising youngsters. The Dons were picking up more wins and conceding fewer goals, and although they missed out on the top six, Three straight victories after the split saw the team clinch seventh place, a significant step up from the previous campaign. The supporters saw reason for optimism, and the board of directors agreed. Ebbe signed a new contract and set about thrilling Scottish football with a side packed with talented kids. Three early defeats were soon forgotten as Kevin McNaughton, Philip Maguire, the young brothers Darren and Derek, and Darren Mackey made themselves fixtures in the starting lineup. Jamie McAllister was also restored, and runs were given to the likes of Chris Clark and Fergus Tiernan, captain of the youth team who lifted their Scottish Cup by beating Celtic at Hampden. Neither cup competition brought glory, but the SPL campaign was much more impressive. Aberdeen were scoring more goals, winning more games, and playing the sort of attractive football which brought the fans flocking back to Pittodrie. The highlight of the season was a 2-0 beating of champion Celtic in December, the only league defeat suffered by Martin O'Neill's men. The Dons booked a top six finish with games to spare and were only denied third place by losing to the Old Firm in the last couple of matches.
And they have a chance now with Darren Mackey on Mulhallan. And Mulhallan playing it back to Robert Douglas. Oh, what's Douglas doing? It's going to be a goal for Aberdeen. It's all over here. Aberdeen have won this match by 2-0. What a mistake by Robert Douglas. And Pittodrie erupts. M. Scobdal watches on. The anguish on Robert Douglas's face, the euphoria. And of course, the celebrations begin. It's an early Christmas present from Robert Douglas. And Darren Mackey is happy to accept it and wrap up the points for Aberdeen.
Ebbe Scobdal's determination and perseverance had paid off. He never lost faith in his own ability and a total belief in his dressing room of young stars. They repaid him and the fans with the club's best season in years. The foundation had been laid for the future.
I'm used to have the cornerstone in my team, the backbone of my team, of players who has come through the club, because first of all, they have to have the qualities, of course. Next to that, they know the club inside and out. We know them because we know the character, the mental situation they're in, the physical capacity, their tactical and technical capacity, and they won't give us so many surprises because we know what they have inside themselves, and they know the club. So you don't take big chances with that, but you've got to spend a lot of time. The backbone of the team, which is probably four or five players who should be high in the hierarchy as well, because they are the club's own players, is the right blend. But I would definitely say as many as you can take in from your own production. And then if you don't have the perfect winger or flank player or striker or whatever, then you will say, but we don't have him, not next year, not the year after, the next 3 or 4 years, we don't see that in our youth department, so then you go and spend money elsewhere.
There have been many changes behind the scenes during Ebbe Scobdal's reign. The club appointed its first chief executive. Both Gordon Bennett and Dave Cormack filled the role briefly. Now Keith Wyness is guiding the club forward in tandem with Stuart Milne and the board of directors.
After 100 years, Pittodrie is an old lady who's starting to show some flaws, unfortunately. The south stand has some major settlement problems. The main stand is still in really bad repair at present. And in 4 or 5 years, we'll have serious problems with each one. Given to that, the importance is now of corporate hospitality and the corporate money that we have to get in. It's important we have new facilities, and it's crucial we move forward with it and keep pace with the times. Also, there's the issues of licensing that will be coming up soon with UEFA, and Pittodrie may not pass those tests in a few years' time, so we have to be very conscious of that going forward.
And in terms of the youth football, will there be funding made available? Is that the key element now in terms of finding funds to strengthen the squad?
I think funding is important, but in terms of Aberdeen, what we look at is we're going to ring-fence the youth funding more than any other club that I'm aware of. And we're going to make sure that it becomes a priority rather than just a secondary thought, as it is in other clubs. It really will be coming to the forefront for us, and we're going to make sure that is the case. It's a very strange time in Scottish football in general right now as we come to the last of the 100 years, and it is a difficult challenge. We've certainly started things in the right direction, I think, in terms of the youth development, and that must be the keynote as we go forward into the next 25 years.
The fans now have a direct input into what happens in the boardroom. In March 2002, Chris Gavin was appointed as supporters' representative on the board.
Everything comes my way. Nobody's held back at any time. They've been quite welcoming and encouraged me to get involved, which, of course, is the whole point of the exercise.
Is there a different mentality within the boardroom now in terms of their approach to the fans?
I think so. I think they do want to know what the fans are thinking about various things. It's quite interesting at the moment, though, because I thought that in the position that I found myself, I would have people coming to me with big issues, and they just haven't been doing it. So it may be that fans are happier with the way things are at the moment than I would have expected, and certainly I would like to see improvements that I'm not being asked for by the supporters.
I don't know about anybody else, but I've never been more proud of a team than the team we've got just now, because most of them are from up here again. I mean, they've got so much pride in the team, and I mean, every week they love pulling on that jersey and going out there and performing in front of everybody.
I think that's what Skodal wants as well. He's building a team unit, and he doesn't want any dissidents in it who'd rock that boat. And I think if he continues, that'll be the way that will go.
There are few clubs in Scotland which can claim a supporter who's written his own chapter in the sporting history books. But world-famous golfer Paul Lawrie did just that by winning the Open Golf Championship. No matter where he's playing, his heart is always at Pittodrie.
It's always nice, you know, whenever I win a tournament, which is not all that often, but when it happens now and again, they ask me to come on the pitch and, you know, have a wee wave, which I feel quite uncomfortable about doing because I'm not that kind of person. But I like to sort of get on there and wave. If anyone wants to sort of wave, that's great, you know. But wherever I am in the world, I always get the score, you know, whether I'm Singapore or Australia or wherever. 5 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon, I need to know what the score is.
The future of Pittodrie is in doubt. Plans are well advanced to move to a new custom-built facility, with a Belfield site near King's Wells the preferred option.
I think when you look at it very objectively, if we stay at Pittodrie and redevelop there, we're setting a site that's worth the best part of £10 million. We'd have to spend somewhere in the region of £15 to £18 million to redevelop Pittodrie. Even with that money spent, we would never have a proper stadium there. No, we'd be making that investment still with all the constraints around it. Now, I firmly believe that if we take that £28 million and invest it in a greenfield development, whether that's at Belfield or whether it ends up being somewhere else, I firmly believe that that is a way forward for the club to have a new purpose-built stadium, soccer academy, and everything as part of the stadium setup. I think it would be a tremendous thing to set the club up for the next 100 years.
And the club is investing heavily in its youth development. Gothenburg legend Neil Simpson returned to the Dons to head up the programme. His task is to find and develop the youngsters who it's hoped will one day emulate the greats of days gone by.
You see the emergence of the new Aberdeen football kits now is really incredible. And it's maybe not always finding the talented player, but it's really promoting the club. And if they're not going to be a really talented kid, they'll be maybe playing at a different level. Or if not, then they're going to be a supporter of the club. You know, there's a lot of talented kids, and we're here at Banff, and there's two kids who have just signed for the club from the area. So, you know, it's not just Aberdeen City, it's like the whole northeast of Scotland, where, you know, children are getting an opportunity.
The first 100 years of Aberdeen Football Club has been laden with drama, tension, excitement, and most importantly, success. All the major trophies have been here at Pittodrie in the past. Everyone's aim is to ensure they return in the future. A new stadium, a group of talented young players, drive and ambition. The ingredients are there to make the Dons' next century just as memorable as the first.